Good morning and welcome to tNCC Church at Home. We're glad you can join us on YouTube and Facebook Live, and we trust that you will be blessed this morning. Say hi in the comments section, especially if you're here with us for the first time. Acts 2, you'll have your meeting at 2 p.m. today. Jacqueline will speak on the topic Enough. Please take note of the meeting ID and the password. This Wednesday, we'll continue our new series on the New Covenant. The seventh session is entitled Worship in the New Covenant. It will be led by Pastor Sam and starts at 8:30 p.m. Please register via the link shown or WhatsApp Pastor Clint at 016-600-0907. That's the announcements for today. Let's stand up to worship the Lord joyfully. So stand with me as we sing praises to our Lord.
Good morning, church! So good to see every single one of you. Are you ready to praise and worship our Lord this morning?
Yes.
Isn't it a beautiful day? Come on,
amen.
Let's get up on our feet and praise Him. Are you ready? You can dance, you can jump, you can do whatever you like. Are you ready to praise Him this morning, church?
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus, for all that you've done. Thank you for dying on the cross for us, so that we can stand here today, righteous, whole, healed. We have your strength, we have your wisdom, we have your favor on our side.
Come to your throne, fall on my knees. Where I pour out my soul, you're all I need. Rain upon my life, fill my heart. Take this moment, God.
Moment, God, I am
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that you love us so much. That you've been so, so good to us. Come on, Jesus, let's just sing in your song. I love your voice. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I'm losing of the goodness of God.
Holy Communion this morning, as remember Ecclesiastes chapter 9 verse 7, it says that let us take the bread with a joyful heart and let's partake of the wine with a merry heart. Let's partake of the bread, let's remember what Jesus has done for us. As we are going through these lockdowns after lockdowns, many of people are suffering mental stress, but let's remember what Jesus has done on the cross, taking away our physical diseases, but also giving us peace and joy in our mentally, that we can go through our days, and giving us a strength each day that we can go through our day successfully with our families, with our friends, and be in a good state of health and mind. And let's partake of this bread, remembering that all these health benefits that Jesus gave to us was paid for at the cross. And let's take it with a joyful heart this morning. As we partake of the cup today, let's partake of the cup with a merry heart, knowing that our works have been accepted by the Lord, because our sins have been forgiven, and we are accepted in the Beloved. And all of our work today has been accepted by the Lord, covered by His blood. And as we partake of this cup today, we remember our sins have been thoroughly forgiven once and for all. And what a blessed hope, what a blessed life we have at this time. And let's partake of this cup with a merry heart. Amen.
Good morning, tNCC. This is Church at Home. So glad all of us can be united, celebrating Jesus together, even in our own homes. While we are separated physically, we are united in one spirit with Him. Amen. We are just so glad that we week after week, we can continue to be worshiping Jesus together. We hope that for the day to come soon, that we will be able to gather physically together too. The numbers are coming down, infection numbers are coming down, and it looks like the tide is turning. And thank God for that too. So we are gone through a very difficult time. You know, during this time, we ask many questions. One of the many questions that people ask is how, you know, how can we travel again? How can we gather together again? How can we do the things that we want to do that we have not been able to do the last 1.5 years? How can we travel? How can we lose some of the weight that we have gained during this time? You know, but I want to tell you that the Bible tells us something differently. It is not so much about how we can do something, or how we can find happiness, or become rich, how we can expand our business, how we can advance in our careers, how can we enjoy our life. The Bible talks about not so much about how. The Bible says, first of all, the question you need to ask is who. Not so much how, but who. Just change the order of the words and you get the word who. Who, if you know who you serve, you know whose you are, and if you know who is in charge and leading you, then your life becomes different. Then you don't have to ask how anymore. Is it possible? Yes, of course. Let's look at Psalms 24. I trust that you'll be enjoying, you know, this whole series on Psalms that we've been going through. It's just amazed over how different ones we have been preaching can show us different revelation, what Psalms, the different Psalms are all about. Wish we could go through more of them, but we will go through maybe at another time the later Psalms and so on. But today we're going to look at Psalms 24. Can you read with me together? Let's all read this together. The earth is the Lord's and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein. For He has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend into the hill of the Lord, or who may stand in His holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul to an idol, nor sworn deceitfully. he shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is Jacob, the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face. Selah. Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates, lift up you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Selah. You know, the word Selah appears two times in this psalm. Selah just means a pause. Take a moment to think through this. Take a moment to meditate on this. Amen? Okay. But let's go. But first of all, we need to know, what's the occasion for Psalm 24 to be written? What was the occasion that caused David to write? We are not really told in the psalm itself, but many scholars believe that David wrote this for the occasion when he brought the ark to Jerusalem. You remember that the ark was never in Jerusalem, because David only conquered Jerusalem when he became king and began to reign there. And he wanted the ark to come back. So the ark was actually lost by Saul when he fought with the Philistines. The Philistines took it. Then the Philistines returned it. And then they didn't know what to do with it. And so the Philistines, the Jews kept it in a place called Kiriath Jearim, which is about 10 miles away from Jerusalem. Not very far away. So David wanted to bring, because he has already established himself in Jerusalem. He has built his palace, so he wanted to bring the Ark of the Lord back to Jerusalem. So it was a distance, as I said, about maybe 8-10 miles, not very far away. And so what he did, he caused a new cart to be constructed, and they put the Ark on top of the new cart. And then they brought it along with the cart. You see, David didn't read his Bible properly. I will know why in a while. And so the ox stumbled, and then they were afraid that the ark would slide down. So Uzzah went and tried to prevent the ark from falling off the cart. And as a result, he was struck dead. And so the whole mood changed. They were all thinking that, wow, they're going to bring the ark back. But now the mood changed. And in fact, fear came upon them. So what did they do? They kept the ark in the home of a person called Obed-Edom for 3 months. And then, but when the ark was there in Obed-Edom's house, Obed-Edom prospered. And so 3 months later, David said, no, there must be a way to bring it back. So he searched his scriptures, and he realized, oh, the ark needs to be carried, you know, on the shoulders of the Levites to bring it. And so that's what they did. They began now, again, a new procession from home of Obed-Edom to Jerusalem. And so you had David dancing there, you know, rejoicing that the ark of the Lord, you know, the presence of the Lord, signified by the ark, was going to be in Jerusalem. And they put that ark, and placed that ark in the new tabernacle that David had constructed, that we commonly now call the Tabernacle of David. And it was there, you know, for until the Temple of Solomon was built, it was there for that many years, that people then can rejoice and people can celebrate before the Lord without any curtain, without any heavy curtain shielding the ark away. And in a sense, this was the beginning. This was a foretaste of the worship that today we have before the Lord. Amen? Okay, that was the occasion, bringing the ark of the Lord to Jerusalem. What has that got to do with us? Well, the first thing David started the psalm, he said, the earth is the Lord's and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein. So first of all, we need to know, even in whatever situation we may be in, whether a tragic situation or a situation of rejoicing, we need to know who owns it all. And the Psalms declare clearly, the earth is the Lord's. He didn't just say that. And all its fullness, everything good that you see in the earth, you know, the life you see, the joy you see, and everything good that you see in the earth, is also the Lord. The world and even us belong to the Lord. Amen. Those who dwell in it owe it to the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Psalmist went on to say, and he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. You know, for all we know, David never wandered more than, you know, 1,200 miles away from Jerusalem. And all the seas that he knew was the Mediterranean Sea on the west, and then the River Jordan, and then Sea of Galilee and Dead Sea, you know. Well, small bodies of water. But actually today we know that the earth is more than 70% water. And we are only living on parts of the dry land that's come out of the water. You know, the Bible is so accurate. Thousands of years ago, David was inspired by the Holy Spirit to know that the Lord has created the earth, and the dry land was founded upon the waters. But the main question we want to answer, who owns it all? The Lord owns it all. And if you look at the spelling of the word Lord, it's all in capital, which means Yahweh, the Lord, the covenant-making God, the one who says, I am who I am. I can be who you want me to be to you. That's the Lord. He owns it all. So if the Lord is the big boss, the owner of all it, then how can we approach the Lord? Who may ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or whom may stand in his holy place? You know, those of us who are in business and in fact, in anything you do, like, you know, every time you want to do something, you want to get something done, you say, who is the big boss there? Who is the one who makes the decision? I want to see him so that then the decision can be carried out, right? And so, same thing. Who, if we know he is the Lord, who may ascend into the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? So the next question we need to ask ourselves is this. Can you help me, please? Oh, okay. Who owns it all? We established that. Now, who can stand before him? Who can stand before the Lord? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, and who has not lifted up his soul to an idol and not sworn deceitfully. Let's just quickly look at it. Okay, he who has clean hands, you know, hands means something that you do, you know. Clean hands. Today, because of the pandemic, every day, we are reminded, sanitize your hands, wash your hands, sanitize your hands, and so on. So we are reminded how important having clean hands is, you know. But sometimes, you know, just cleaning your hands doesn't change anything. Right action doesn't change anything. You know, Pilate, you know, when the Jews wanted to crucify Jesus, he went to wash his hands and said, I'm absorbing myself of this act that you want to do. It doesn't change anything. What is important is also that we have a pure heart. The heart, the intentions must be correct. And then David goes on to say, who has not lifted his soul to an idol. No idols. You know, we say, oh, we don't worship any idols, Pastor. Yeah, but what takes the place of God in our lives become an idol? It could be the YouTube, it could be the stock market, it could be some sports that we are engaged in. Whatever it is, anything that the place of God in our lives becomes an idol. And who has not sworn deceitfully, there's no deceit. You know, we are what people see. What you see is what you get. What you see is who I am. And we don't have hidden motives behind us. So, but then when you look at it, none of us qualify. How can we all say we have clean hands, a pure heart, and so on? But you know, the one person who has all this is Jesus Christ. You know, he is the one who has clean hands and pure hearts. No idols before him except his Father. He only worship his Father. He is God himself to be worshipped. No deceit. Everything he says is truth. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. But because of what he has done on the cross, he qualified us. Amen? He qualified us. We then now, because of what he has done for us and because we trust in him, we now can stand before the Lord of Lords, we can stand now in his holy place. Amen. Hallelujah. What's the advantage of standing before him? before the Lord, he shall receive blessing from the Lord. Hallelujah. That's why I said you don't need to ask how. If you can stand before him, if you can stand before the one who owns everything, if you can stand before him with no fear, you know, and just approach him directly, obviously, all that he has, you know, can be yours. Obviously, if you have no unfettered access to the Lord, then his blessings comes to us, you know, just naturally like that. So the psalmist then declared, he shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Hallelujah. You know, so it is not, so if you know who, we don't have to ask how. We don't have to ask how when we stand before the one who owns it all. Hallelujah. Amen. That's why it's so important. First of all, we need to know who owns it all. Secondly, we need to know and remind ourselves that Jesus has qualified us to stand before the Father. And if we can stand before him who owns it all, we will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. You know how accurate David is, that he foresaw 1,000 years forward. That when Paul will write, how much more were those who received God's abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. You know, it was God's grace that enabled us to see what Jesus has done for us and to trust him and to believe in him and to have faith in him. And when we have faith in him, then we receive his gift of righteousness. The gift of righteousness, if we always say righteousness, is the right to stand, right standing before God. Now, again, it's connected to Psalm 24, right standing before God. So this right gift of righteousness, this gift of right standing before God is given to us by God's grace. Amen. And Paul in Romans 5 said that if you have his abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness, we will then reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Will you say amen to that? Amen? Hallelujah. You know, God's provision of grace is an abundant provision of grace. God is not stingy. He gives freely. And because we have this right standing before him, so much more grace is being provided and poured forth through our lives that nothing in this life can stop us from reigning in life. Now, please don't get me wrong. I know some of us are going through difficult issues right now. Some of us are going through difficult health issues. Some of us are going through difficult financial issues. Some of us are going through very troubling family issues and so on. But reigning in life, I mean, but any monarch will tell you that he has many problems, you know. But reigning in life means being able to go above all these problems and know that in the end, he will work it all out for our good. And how do we reign in life? The Bible is very clear. Through one man, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Will you say amen to this? Amen. Verse 5 goes on to verse 6, you know, righteousness from the God of his salvation. Verse 6 says, this is Jacob, the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, Selah. So, David in the psalm said, you know, we are like Jacob, the generation who seek the Lord, who seek the face of the Lord, Selah. Think for a while, meditate on it for a while. Who is this Jacob? What? Why? First time, you know, many of you would have heard that Jacob, David referring to Jacob as David referring to their people there as a generation of Jacob. You know, Jacob in Genesis 32, I think Pastor Sam alluded to this some weeks ago about how Jacob was going to meet his brother Esau. He was afraid. He sent his servants forward with all the gifts and so on. And then he sent his family across the Jabbok River, a little brook. And then he stayed on this other side. And that night, That night, the Lord met him. The Lord, and he wrestled with the Lord all night long, and he would not let go. And he told the Lord, I will not let go. The Lord said, hey, dawn is coming. Let me go. He said, no, I will not let go unless, until you bless me. And so the Lord changed his name from Jacob to Israel, from a conniver, from a thief, to the prince of God. Amen. And bless him. So this is a Jacob. This is a Jacob generation that David was talking about. He's saying that we are going to be like people who will take hold of God and wrestle with God until he blessed us. You know, but that was Jacob's generation, you know. And in fact, he called that place Peniel, which means the face of God. So it's all connected. If you know Genesis 32, then you understand this little phrase, this little verse from Psalms 24, verse 6. You know? So he said, I called the place Peniel because I've seen the face of God and I did not die. Hallelujah. But that was Jacob's generation. But you know, today, we are in Jesus' generation, not Jacob's generation. And therefore, his promises to us, you know, comes differently. His grace to us comes in a different way. We don't have to struggle with him. We don't have to cajole him, you know. Yes, we seek him, and then he will just bless us. Ephesians 1 talks about how the Lord has chosen us and, you know, to be his and to be adopted as children. And then he goes on to say that to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given to us in the one he loves. The Lord says, to the praise of his glorious grace, the grace, you know, his abundant provision of grace now is a glorious grace. It's going to be a good grace. Whatever he gives it is so good. It's going to be a glorious grace. Then we don't have to struggle with him to get it like Jacob. In Christ Jesus, he freely gives it to us. Can you say it after me? I freely receive all that he has freely given to me in Christ Jesus. Amen. That's the promise we have as the Jesus generation. Hallelujah. Then the next few verses talks about gates. David changes focus. David said, lift up your gates, lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting gates, and the King of glory shall come in. Now, I put out a picture of what an ancient gate would look like. You know, these are like the shutter doors that we have today. You know, it comes down. And the first part of the gate is this thing with that sharp pointed things down there. And how do they bring it up? They tie ropes to it, they winch it up, and they secure it down there. But then, why do we need a gate like this? So that when people want to come in, you know, they want to prevent the enemies from coming in, they just cut the ropes or they quickly release the rope, this first gate becomes first defense, you know. They don't have to wait for somebody to push through the doors to be closed. Then after that, they can close the doors. Okay, if you want to keep people in and not allow people to go out, there's somebody rob somebody or somebody steal somebody, and they want to prevent the robber or thief from going out, they just let down these gates, and so that, you know, it's a secure thing. But David said, lift up your gate, lift up your heads, all you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Now you will notice that this occurs, if you have been listening while we were reading it just now and observing it, you know that this verse occurred twice. Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Verse 7, verse 9. And in between, the responses are in verse 8. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. And then verse 10. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory, Selah. Now, why would there be two different responses to this question, who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty and better, the Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory. You know, some people say, oh, you know, for emphasis. But I believe that the Holy Spirit has a very particular lesson for us here. And sometimes we miss it. And he would not have recorded it such if there is no specific purpose for him. Okay? So who is this King of Glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. So the Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle. You know, Jesus, at the appointed time, took the form of man and became flesh and dwelt in our midst. He had a purpose to fulfill. And the devil knows it. And the devil threw everything at Jesus to prevent him from carrying out the purpose for which he has come to do. But yet, in his life, you know, Jesus defeated Satan and his many plans. You know, just after his baptism, when he was in the desert, preparing to go into his ministry for the 3 years of ministry, the devil confronted him in the desert after his fast of 40 days and gave him three different basic temptations, threw at him three basic temptations that we all face. You know, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And Jesus overcame this temptation of Satan. That along his ministry, he sent he sent his minions, his machai there to go and, you know, disturb Jesus. And yet Jesus, you know, Jesus showed that he these are no match for him. He just overthrew all of them. He even convinced the Pharisees and the scribes and so on to get Jesus to be put before the Roman authorities. And how we got Jesus flogged, you know, until, if you have read the scriptures, you'll know that he's become unrecognizable. He suffered so much physically, and yet Jesus was steady. He got one of Jesus' disciples to be a traitor, to arrange all this. And so they finally took him and put him on the cross. The worst death anybody could have died. And yet when he was hanging there, then suddenly maybe Satan thought that, hey, maybe something not so right. Yeah? He's still there. He got the people to mock him and say, if you are God, come down. If you are the Messiah, come down. So that Jesus may abort his mission in this way, you know, to get away from the suffering. But Jesus stood his course. And then he died. And in that death, today we look back, we know he has defeated sin and death. Because the penalty of sin is that when he died on the cross, he died for us, for our sins. He died as us, and therefore freeing us from death and sin. Hallelujah. Amen. But how do we know? How do we know that he has died? Because on the third day, even though they got the Roman soldiers to guard the tomb, they put a stone over the tomb and sealed it so that nobody can come. But that stone could not hold him. No tomb can hold him. No death can hold him. He arose, hallelujah. He arose. And because he arose, we know that all that he has come to do has been accomplished. It is truly finished. And he has done it well. He has paid more than enough. And so that sin is utterly defeated. He is the Lord, mighty in battle. He is the Lord, strong and mighty. Amen. Over Satan. Then he appeared. He appeared before different ones, his disciples. He appeared before Mary Magdalene. He appeared before the disciples. He appeared before the two disciples walking on the road to Emmaus. And then when Thomas said, no, I don't believe all this because I didn't see Jesus, he intentionally made appearance before Thomas so that Thomas can see his nail-pierced hands. And then he appeared before Peter and some of the disciples who were fishing to restore Peter back to the ministry. And so he appeared, you know, he conquered that. And then to ensure that they all know and fully understand that he conquered that, he appeared before them. In fact, the scripture says at one time he appeared before 500 people. And then he took his disciples to the Mount of Olives. And then he told them that they are to remain. They are to remain in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit come upon them. And they will be his witnesses. And then he began to bless them. They saw his nail-pierced hands. And as he rose majestically up into the sky, they saw his feet that were pierced, you know. And then they saw him no more. The disciples didn't know what happened next. But David, looking ahead 1,000 years, 1,000 years ahead, he knew, inspired by the Holy Spirit, he penned these words down. He said, "Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in." Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. You know, Jesus, when he ascended heaven, he appeared before the pearly gates. Now, just before that, do you know that Jesus' ascension day is such an important part of our Christian faith? But yet, so many of us don't know it. We know about Christmas, we know Easter, but we know Pentecost, but we don't even celebrate Ascension Day. There are only about a dozen countries in the world that allows Ascension Day to be a public holiday. And one of them is Indonesia, of all countries, the biggest Muslim nation in the world. But okay, coming back to this, Jesus appeared, you know, before the pearly gates of heaven. And then he shouted, "Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting gates, and the King of glory shall come in." Who is this King of glory? The gatekeeper asked, Who is this King of glory? He saw this man there, you know, standing there. And who is this King of glory? And the Lord replied, "The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. He has won the victor's crown. He has defeated Satan. He has defeated sin and death." And therefore he says, "The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle, and the King of glory shall come in." Hallelujah. And so he went in. He went in and then sat at the right hand of God the Father. The Father welcomed him and said, the right hand is a place of authority. And he sat down there and sat down at the right hand of God the Father. Hallelujah. And then, so where was Jesus? After verse 8, he was seated at the Father's right hand. And what happened? He told the disciples that wait in Jerusalem for the promise of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit came on Pentecost Day. And then they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And Peter spoke. And then that began the church age. And up to now, we are still in that church age of, you know, after 2,000 years. And the gospel has been spreading from the day of Pentecost, 3,000 people, and then numbers added daily to the church. And then sometimes at different points in time, thousands came through. At some other points in time, one or two here, one old man, one young boy, one young lady, you know, they all came, different from different cultures. Some slaves came in, some rich people came into the kingdom, into this new covenant. The Holy Spirit has been working. And the Holy Spirit continues to work up to today. That's why today, 2,000 years later, people like us can then be part of this new covenant. Hallelujah. You know, I just want to spend a few minutes just going through some of the things that the Lord has shown me over the last few, how the church has been expanding. You know, in the 80s, I was traveling to East Berlin and Russia for some business and all this. And I saw how the Iron Curtain had kept people in. How in Berlin, the Berlin Wall kept, you know, surrounded West Berlin. And so they protected basically the East Berliners from the influence of the West Berliners. And they were atheistic in nature and so on. But, you know, at the appointed time in 1989, the walls came crumbling down and the people suddenly became free. I couldn't imagine that it could happen, because just to go through Chalik checkpoint, they make you wait for so long there as they check this and check that, and make it so difficult to come in and to go out. And yet, at the right time, it all just came and the people were free indeed. Same thing happened in Russia. It was USSR, you know, a big, big country with different republics, and suddenly Gorbachev said, dissolved the whole USSR. And today, Russia is also open and free. And actually, I had the privilege of going to Russia for 2 mission trips there to plant churches there. The Lord, no Berlin Wall, no Iron Curtain can keep the Lord, because He is the Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Hallelujah. You know, you look at China. After World War II, Mao Zedong came in power. Actually, when I look back, I realize the Lord has something to do with it. You see, the Chinese, thousands of years, you know, were steeped in ancestral worship and in their idolatry. And it's so difficult to break through all these chains. But it all just took one man. The Lord just raised up one man. For whatever you say about him, he cut it off, cut all the religious ties off. He even chased Christian missionaries out of China. And I was one of the beneficiaries of them, because I, in my early years as a young boy, it was the missionaries who helped me to read the Bible and study the Bible. And I owe a lot of gratitude to the OMF missionaries who were there, who had actually escaped from China. And yet, you know, Mao Zedong introduced the Chinese script, which was a simplified new script. And so that in the past, only the Mandarins, only the highly educated could read. But because of the simplified script, you know, everybody now can read and write. And because of that, the gospel spread. Even though the missionaries are all thrown out, the Lord in His own way caused the gospel. Some 10 years ago, I heard reading somewhere, they say over 100 million people in China are Christians. And some of the churches are all underground. In fact, those that are above ground, even if you go to Beijing for all these three self-churches, they are packed every Sunday. 7-8 services, one after another. And people line up just to get in every Sunday. You know, the Lord, no red curtain can stop the Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle, through His Holy Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. And today, do you know where is the fastest growing church in the world? You'll be surprised. They tell me it is in Iran. Where is the second fastest growing church in the world? It is in Afghanistan. But you say, Pastor, you know, Iran just elected a hardline president. And then the Taliban just took over. And they're persecuting the church. You know, but I want to tell you, the Lord that we serve is the Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. And no green curtain of any kind can also stop it. And one day, when the gospel has been preached to all nations, when everyone have an access to this gospel, and it's in our time, in our generation, because today, through the internet, through all the different media, the gospel can be spread to all nations. Jesus will come again. Amen. Jesus will come again. And then He will bring us. He will come again, and He will gather us all up. And then He will say to the gates, "Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting door, and the King of glory shall come." You know, He will gather us. All those who have gone before us, all those of us who are alive today, when He comes, on the day when He comes, together with all the angelic hosts, and then will be a huge triumphal procession to the gates of heaven. And then he will shout out to the gatekeeper, "Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in." And the gatekeeper asks, "Who is this King of glory?" And you say, "The Lord of hosts, He is the King of glory." Hallelujah! Aren't you excited? Yeah, that we have a glorious hope in front of us, that we can all be part of that majestic procession. We can all be part of that host that accompany Jesus, and He comes again and takes us through the gates of heaven. And David ends it with Selah. I know this sometimes overwhelms you, just as it has overwhelmed me when I began to read it and ponder over it. But would you take a moment just to think about it? What a glorious advantage. What a glorious privilege to be part of the host that accompanies the King of Glory as He enters into through the heavenly gates. Amen. Hallelujah. You ask me, so just very quickly, just summarizing, who owns it all? We already covered it. We know that the Lord owns it all. Who can stand before Him? All those who know Jesus as the Lord and Savior can stand before Him. Who is the King of Glory? He is the King of Glory. Jesus is the King of Glory, and He's coming for us again. Hallelujah. So what has that got to do with me, Pastor? You know, the scripture in Revelation tells us this: "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me." Now, this morning, Jesus is standing at some of you, at the doors of some of you. Some of you have come and stumbled upon this broadcast. Some of you are listening to it. Maybe some weeks later, some months later, somewhere, whatever it is. Or some of you have been part of our church, but you have never invited Jesus in. He's still knocking on your door. He said, lift up your heads, all you gates. Lift up your heads. You know, be lifted up, you door of this person's heart, whatever your name is. He's knocking on the door. He said, if you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and dine with you. I will fellowship with you, and I will confer upon you my gifts of righteousness and my abundant provision of grace to you. Some of you may have gone very far away from the Lord. Say, how is it? But this morning, the Lord is also calling you. The Lord is also saying, come back. Some of you have maybe neglected the Lord over the last one and a half years because of this pandemic. But the Lord is also calling you to come back. Will you? He's at the door of your heart this morning. Just as He was at the heavenly gates, He is taking time this morning to be at your door, at the door of your heart. Would you open the door and invite Him? Invite Him to come in? Amen? If you're one of them, yeah, that wants to invite Jesus into your life, can I ask that you pray with me? Can I get the whole church, all of us, let's pray together. Okay? Lord Jesus, we thank you that you're constantly at our door, at the door of our hearts, that you're knocking, you want to come in. And this morning, Lord, I invite you to come into my life. I take hold of your promise that you will come in. When I hear your voice, open the door of my heart. You will come in, and you have fellowship with me. And you know, when you have fellowship with me, you will give me the gift of your righteousness and your abundant provision of grace. I acknowledge all that you have done for me on the cross, that you have taken away my sins, and in its place, you have given me your righteousness. You have taken away all my curses, and in its place, you have given me your abundant provision of grace. And I thank you, and I know that even as I pray this prayer, you are with me. In Jesus' name, amen. The Lord has spoken to you. Praise the Lord. We have a glorious hope. The King of Glory is coming back again to bring us back unto Him. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great week ahead.
That's the end of today's service. Thank you for joining us at tNCC Church at Home. Our prayer assist Zoom rooms are now open. If you'd like to find out more about Jesus, join us too, and someone will be happy to share with you. Or WhatsApp us at the number anytime. Have a blessed week, and we'll meet again next Sunday.